KPTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. I'd like to remind our viewers that Burke's Bards has a first Thursday every first Thursday of the month at 6 o'clock in the Goggle Works, and you're welcome to come. We usually have a featured reader and an open mic that's free and open to the public. And we also have Second Tuesday, which meets at Aladdin's in West Reading at 6 o'clock on the second Tuesday of every month. And that's just poets gathering to share their work over a nice meal. Let me share the bio that I have for my poet this evening. This poet was just been named Berks County Poet Laureate. And her reign will last until 2021, when we elect a new Berks County Poet Laureate. She's retired from Penn State Berks campus, where she was a creative writing and composition teacher for 18 years. She has an MFA from San Diego State University in creative writing and poetry. Her book, which you could almost call my first book, yes, as well as the title, My First Tree, comes from Foothills Publishing. It has a charming poem in it that I absolutely love, which the title of the book was taken from. And she's also had a poem called Finding Her Here, translated into Spanish, Chinese, and Russian, commissioned for a song for a women's chorus, mm-hmm, and a poster that even produced royalty checks.
That's
which
right.
is wonderful.
It's like, amazing.
Oh my God, our writer got
right. It's a rarity for
checks.
Poets, right?
And the her favorite words come from Mary Oliver. Now she has another set of lines from this same poem that she keeps over her writing desk, but these are some of the lines at the end of the poem of Wild Geese by Mary Oliver. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over announcing your place in the family of things. So welcome my guest, Jayne Relaford Brown. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a nice reading of that.
Thank you.
And thank you for saying you liked
My
First
Love
Real
this
Tree.
I love this.
I will have to read that tonight.
Okay. Would you share some of your work? I would love to hear your material.
I will be happy to. And I love requests. So I'll start with My First Real Tree. And there it is. This poem includes absolutely everything I know about the visual arts, which I acquired in seventh grade. And you'll recognize the seventh grade conceptual learning. So this is My First Real Tree. Proud in my father's former shirt, my smock, I measure black and white in every primary pint, make the butcher paper thick with tinted blonde and gold rust bark, to catch a eucalyptus branchy sweep, its dusty green and silver leaves. The third grade comes, a field trip to the room that will be theirs next year. Gosh, one whispered, look what she can do. And this is not a lollipop I've drawn, not the stick and circle of my youth. This is my first real tree, because I've been given art to see. Look, Miss Desmond told us, not a line across the top. The blue of sky goes the whole way down. How could that be? The air around me's clear, just blue when I look up. Look farther out, she pointed. See the hills? And then I saw it. Sky reached all the way to earth. I lived in sky. All day long I'd spun around, tried to see the blue I must be walking through. I smile at those children, sight beyond my outheld brush toward my tree. Soon enough they'll see. This year they think the sky is like a ceiling. Still feel satisfied with 8 or 16 crayons. Have no idea that light hits everything along one side, that shadows huddle under fruit and basketballs, that everything converges, disappears in one small dot at the world's edge.
And I think the reason I love that is we're both newly retired.
Yes.
And I have gone back to painting.
Oh, something, wonderful.
Something I abandoned when my daughter was born, because
excellent.
Oil paint does not mix with a baby.
With kids. And, right, right.
It's like oil and water, no
yeah.
mixture.
No, that's wonderful.
So when you deliver this poem, and this book was put out in 2004, I think
mm-hmm.
we said, you know, I don't know exactly. I must have heard it maybe about 2006 or something
mm-hmm.
shortly after that. I, you know, I know where you were at.
Thank you.
And I understand that you have a new book that you're planning.
I am. That's one of my goals for the, I think the Poet Laureate position has really helped me go the next notch in taking myself seriously.
Good.
And that's sort of my equivalent to your painting. It's like, finally I'm retired, I have the headspace, instead of reading everyone else's poems and helping them make their poems better, I can work with my own and make mine better and
yeah.
better. So to feel that I have that time
yeah.
And that creativity time is a wonderful thing.
Share some more of your work if you would.
I'd be happy to.
Thank you.
Let's see. I have some post-its in here, and I just opened up to Skylight, which is a poem about crushing on somebody, having a really strong crush and incipient love, and that moment where the bubble's about to burst, where I have to tell them, would it be worse to tell them or not tell them? And so this is Skylight. Lie here, you say. The clouds are sailing by. The wind's picked up. Careful not to touch. I stretch along your body. Place my head a fraction of an inch from yours, inside the small square of light-charged air that heats your comforter. Look up, you murmur. See the way they slide? I watch, grow dizzy with the pace, as white silks slip across the turquoise frame, as your cool breath moves moist against my ear. This is where I love to lie and dream, you say. And here's the moment I could tell you, I've been dreaming too, of you. Or simply turn my face and meet your lips. The moment I could trust I understand your hints and why you've brought me to this place. And if I kissed you softly as a cloud, traveled over you as slowly as a mist, and entered you as gentle as a fog, would I be as welcome as a rain? Would you lie still, watch the sky as if I wasn't touching you? Would you run? Or would you sigh so glad to finally have the waiting done, and turn to me, and like a storm, could we together gather.
That is so good.
Thank you.
That is so good.
I'll tell you part of the inspiration. I was watching a Charlie Chaplin movie.
Uh-oh.
And there's a movie where he's in love with, I want to say she's the blind girl, but I'm not positive about this. But he's in love with her and can't tell her, and he's standing behind her. She's sitting in a chair, and you can just see him, you know, it's silent. And you can
right.
just see him kind of going like this and thinking about how he feels. And it made me think about how powerful a repressed feeling was as mm-hmm. opposed to an expressed feeling, because then it's generated its power. But if it's held in, it's like watching an actor trying not to cry.
Right.
It's so much more powerful than
tears.
And
it will push the audience into emotion.
That's what you hope.
Yes. I had the pleasure of reading one of my husband's poems, and it's bound to make me cry.
Uh-huh.
And I had to do it for an audience, and I could not have the feeling. I had to let them have the feeling.
Oh, right, right.
So I had, yeah.
You can't cry.
You can't, you know, and that's what those actors are doing.
That's
and
right.
It's just so strong.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, and I am a crier, you know, like I cry at commercials and everything. So,
dog food commercials, yeah.
Whatever, anything. And so I know I can come to that point of quaver if I'm reading a poem in public, but you don't want to go over it
right.
and lose it. So
right.
I'm going to do a persona poem. So this is in the voice of someone else, not the poet. And I always tell my students, we assume poems are fiction, even they may or may not be. You can lie in poems if you tell the deeper truth. You can lie about the facts because they're just the facts. But this is a persona poem, and since it's Pride Month this month, I wanted to read it. It's called Queen Dowager's Soliloquy, and it's in honor of several men from my past who were lovely and helpful when I was a young mom and were wonderful friends. So, Queen Dowager's Soliloquy, for Hobie and Padraic, and for John, who is gone. You should have seen me at the bar last night, 2 hours before they kicked me out, and Michael even introducing me as Duchess so-and-so. No, not Windsor, dear, but close. Seriously, thank you for the blouse. I wish you'd borrow the silk kimono when you throw your Christmas bash. It was so kind of you to include me in your holidays. I've bought presents for the kids, and I promise I'll behave. Lower my voice and all, and keep a stiff upper wrist. Oh, I wish you could have seen me, though. Oh, do you suppose I could borrow your black jacket tomorrow? Now it's John that's gone, poor boy. God, I'm sick of funerals. It's just so odd. I've wept into my beer for years because no one wants an old queen with sagging jowls and bags below the eyes. And now these cute young boys are dying in droves. And I'm alive. Celibate against my will, God knows, but I'm alive. And who knows? It could be years before cirrhosis does me in. Anyway, thanks for the cocoa. Give the kids a kiss for me. I really must go. It's happy hour, you know?
That is so strong.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. So strong and so sad. I like those poems where you write in a voice, and they come through you so powerfully
mm-hmm.
at times.
You can.
And I'm going like, oh my God.
You can channel somebody.
Yeah. Do you have more to read?
Let me read a brand new one. So that's one from older. So this is the working title is The Losing Poem. I think it's going to be called Losing It. And it's an example of one thing I've learned is you can write about your fears, and it helps put the fears in a package and put them out there. So there's a great catharsis of writing about something you're anxious about. So as a senior, one thing we're often anxious about is, are we maintaining our mental health? The losing poem. Yesterday, I didn't recognize my purse. Last year, I didn't recognize my friend. To be fair, the purse was nondescript. The friend had makeup on, a dress, and contacts in. I've never liked that purse. Plain black vinyl, cheap, it works. But I had always liked my friend. I know I'm not the first to fear the worst, to wait for senior moments that don't end, for lapses that extend to loss of words, abyss, or worse. My father didn't recognize his house. My mother learned to lie, to leave and come back in the door, a cheery, "Dear, I'm home," in hopes of jogging him. I hope that's not my portion of the family curse. I cannot change my chromosomal blend, but just in case, I'm learning to pretend. I've armed myself with filler words like "who's its thingy" to stick in. I've bought myself a memorable purse. I've been forgiven by my friend. There is no art to losing it, no thing to master to blend in if that disaster's destined to descend. Toward the end, my father only recognized his mother, brothers, all long past. And if I'm dancing toward the cliff edge of that curse, I'll curse it, dancing hand in hand with father's ghost.
I'm going to take a few moments right now to remind our viewers that we have a theme this month, which was for June. It was heating up. And we are going to be announcing the next month's theme, which is going to be Freedom's Ring for July. Let me read a few lines of this is a viewer's poem, and it's titled "Tis I, Danny Reed, at the Microphone Stand." I love language, any language. I like words, the sounds of words. I like to twist and bend the meanings of words to magnify the illiterate, thereby creating a dialect all my own. As a poet, I'm expected to do this, to enrich my personal lexicon. Neurolinguists cause our demands to expand because it is my language we command. And with my own tongue, call across the land by telephone or letter or internote, and 'tis I, Danny Reed, at the microphone stand. So thank you, Danny Reed, for sending that in. And I'm hoping that the staff in the control room will put up the prompt for Freedom's Ring, which is 17 lines of poetry on that theme. And the email information is there. And send it to me by July 9th, and I can maybe read your poem on the air. Mm-hmm. So we'll go back to Jayne Relaford Brown then. And if you would give us some more poems.
All right. I'll read one to follow up on my father and what he dealt with. This is a palinode, and a palinode is something you used to hate, and now you're writing an ode to it, or something honoring it. So one thing I really hated was weather talk. You know, I'll tell you in the poem. So this is a palinode to weather talk for my father. You hold the cordless, circumnavigate the driveway, watering geraniums you don't recall you watered yesterday. That's what you call it, circumnavigate, a word you're pleased to put your tongue around. You're like our old cat who used to make us mad by sneaking up and drinking from our water cups. The one who, now she's dying, has a special glass we keep topped up. All your life, We finished sentences for you. We rushed you. A wife and daughters talking circles over you and let the real talk stop when you walked in. Oh, hello there. Is it hot out? Did you take your insulin? Now that every sentence hides a dozen snares, each phrase a maze or thicket to get lost inside, we wait in silence as you fumble toward your ends. Once I scorned our weather talk, thought of it like Naugahyde, Formica, fake, a sign of everything we'd circumnavigate to keep things safe. Now that past and future have abandoned you, and nouns, tell me morning fog and sun, as long as we have left. Let our little dialogues repeat themselves so faithfully, they wear a path for you to find your way along, a route as clear as the two black lines that mark your nighttime shuffling track from bedroom to the bathroom door and back.
Now, I know you have said that being given the honor of Berks County Poet Laureate, mm-hmm. that you want to do interesting things.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that you have shared with me is that you're hoping to show up at our second Tuesday events with writing prompts.
Yes, I will do that. I will do that.
And we are looking forward to that. Now, I have to tell everyone in the viewing audience that this coming second Tuesday, which will be in July, some of us are going to be doing a road trip to Westchester. And pay attention to the Berks Bard's emails that come out. Mm-hmm. About that. And if you want to, you can join us. Or if you're just not able to travel, feel free to gather at Aladdin's and share your poetry. And maybe you'll go with us to Westchester. Maybe you'll show up in Aladdin's. We don't know.
I can't be both places.
But I am looking forward to that.
Thank you. Well, if not then in August, yeah.
Okay. Definitely. Do you have more poems you'd like to read?
Let's see if I could do a short one. I seem to be on sad things today. I apologize.
That is typical for poets.
It is. We write the things we want to get out. It's hard. Writing a happy poem is a challenge. All right. I'll read this expeditiously. This is called Her Left Eyebrow. This is from you want a writing prompt? The writing prompt is write about a part of a person you love, just a part. This is about the left eyebrow of my mother. It raises, it cocks, it praises, it mocks. I learned early to watch that eyebrow, the way I learned to read the weather of a room. It could signal encouragement or warn me to back off. It told me whether she wanted Irish spaghetti or Spanish rice quickie for supper, whether she thought my news story was funny, whether to dress my little brother in blue onesies or the yellow giraffe pajamas. I'll just read the next stanza.
We've got time.
Okay. The eyebrow was the last of her to go. Eyes closed, mouth slack. She moved between labored breathing and finally drifting mostly on a morphine float. But when my sister asked her, are you hearing all the nice things we're saying about you? Up went the eyebrow, pleased. When one of the men she fondly called the gay dads visited from church, she managed smiles we hadn't roused for days. What are we, my brother asked, chopped liver? Up it cocked, a well-timed laugh. It was how she answered yes to sips of apple juice, a sponge of water on her lips. When I tried to feed her rice pudding from a spoon and said, my kids have told me I'm terrible at this, the eyebrow rose in arch agreement. Her eyes popped open for a moment once, and the eyebrow frowned and furrowed to find she wasn't done. I have to get this over with to make the movie stop, she said. When the eyebrow finally lay still, it told me she was gone.
That is so moving, and thank you so much.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you.
I know we're running out of time, and they'll be soon telling us to say goodbye. So that's kind of like the best poem to end with.
To go out on.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
And I really look forward to you coming and doing those writing prompts for us.
Thank you. I'm looking forward to it,
That's
going to
be a lot of fun.
Yeah. You can do a lot in 10 minutes.
Yes, yes. So thank you so much.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you for doing this.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.